Through the season of Advent, please join us in beginning our worship services with prayer and contemplation, observing the incense that thickens the air, reminding us that the Holy Spirit is with us. Observe the lit candles on the Advent wreath. Help us mark time as we anticipate Christ's new birth in our hearts and our lives. Join in the singing of the Tese refrain that calls our attention to the ongoing need for justice and peace for all God's children.
The fourth Advent candle is a symbol of God's love for us and our love for one another. For God rejoices over us with gladness and renews us in divine love. God exults over us with singing and turns our shame to praise.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Purify our conscience, Almighty God, by your daily visitation, that your Son, Jesus Christ, at his coming, may find in us a mansion prepared for himself, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. When the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all the enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See, now I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." And Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the Lord came to Nathan. "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived into a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. But I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep, to be a prince over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people of Israel, and will plant them so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. Hear the Spirit of the Lord to the people, saying, please join me in reading the Song of Mary. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. And from this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy. The promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to God, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from Romans. Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the people. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord. A dad sat down with his four-year-old, hoping to teach the true meaning of Christmas. They began the project of assembling a cardboard cutout nativity scene, stable, manger, baby Jesus, Mary and Joseph, sheep and shepherds. "Fold on the dotted line," the directions said. "Place tab A into slot B," and so on. Easier read than done, of course, and within a few minutes it was a disaster. Nothing worked as intended. Nothing looked like the picture on the box. The dad had all but taken over, and he fared no better than his young child. The kitchen table was littered with torn, bent, spineless figures wilting over. Pieces were frayed and taped together. The father, in his frustration, was close to clearing the table and trashing the whole thing. And the little boy, less than impressed, was looking at this scene on the table. The little boy who was supposed to be learning the real meaning of Christmas, that Jesus is God's son, said, "So, Daddy, where is God in all this mess?" Sounds like a perfect question for 2020. Where exactly is God in all this mess? Our Old Testament and Gospel readings give us a clue where God is in the messes of our lives. Did you hear it? The Lord is with you. God is with you. Bidden or not bidden, God is present. Part of what makes Advent such a special season is the anticipation of the Incarnation. That holy mystery where God puts flesh on and moves into the neighborhood, moves right into our lives. It is the season where we anticipate Emmanuel, God with us, where we are comforted to remember that God came in love to be with us and remains with us even in the moments when we doubt and wonder. Perhaps you wonder in the loss of friends or loved one, where God is in your grief. Maybe you've lost a job and are wondering where God is in your uncertainty. Or perhaps you watch the news to hear of the ongoing upheaval and dis-ease and disease in our country, in our world, and wonder where God is in all the chaos and confusion, where God is in the political maneuverings, in the racial injustices in our nation. Our Advent claim is that God is right here in the middle of the mess with us, just as God was in the middle of the mess with David and with Mary. We hear the prophet Nathan tell David not only that God is with him, but that God has been with him wherever he has been. God does not want David to build him a house of cedar. Clearly, God prefers living in a tent where God can pull up the stakes and move along with us wherever we may go. Linger for a moment over the idea of a God who is constantly ready to pull up stakes and move wherever we go, sleep wherever we sleep, and be buffeted by the same winds that toss us about in life. I can't help but imagine God hanging out at the tent village where the homeless live under the freeway at 30 in Lancaster. Do they know Emmanuel, God with them on these cold winter nights? The Lord is with you was Gabriel's greeting to Mary. Mary wasn't much different from the homeless herself. She was a member of the poorest class of Hebrew people, the Anawim, a Hebrew word that means the poor who depend on the Lord for deliverance. These are the ones for whom Mary sang of God's salvation, saying God looked in favor on the lowly servant. God lifted up the lowly and filled the hungry. Mary and her people lived in a world controlled by mighty Rome, the superpower that ordered a census devised to document the undocumented for government control and to ensure taxation of the most vulnerable. To some, this may sound like current events. Mary, a female teenager where men held all the power and influence, a rural Palestinian Jew in a Roman Empire, a revolutionary in a culture that crucified revolutionaries. Mary was the last person one might expect to say yes to God and to sing this song of God's deliverance. Disrupting the way the world is set up takes great courage, willpower, and faith. When Mary sang that the Lord was brought down, would bring down rulers from their thrones, anybody hearing it would have known that she meant Herod the Great, a ruthless king installed by Rome. Some people might have worried about her singing about the end of Herod's reign. Doing so might get her tried for treason or worse. But as she proclaimed God's new rule of law, Mary sang her heart out. Mary's message was that through God's action, the social hierarchy of wealth and poverty, power and subjugation is to be turned upside down. A new social order of justice is at hand. Mary's message is one that still speaks today in social, political, and economic arenas. Socially, the proud are scattered and the outcast receive God's favor. Politically, the oppressors will be defeated and their victims will be freed. Economically, the hungry are fed and those who have withheld the food are sent away. It is time to claim for ourselves the great disruption announced in Mary's song. She sang it not for herself, wrote Martin Luther, but for all of us to sing it after her. God's powerful vision, as proclaimed by Mary, demands our action. We are summoned to build a just world by the God who regards the poor and the poorly treated with utmost mercy. This Advent, will you say yes to God who is with you and who calls you to strive for justice for all God's children? Will you stand with the poor and lonely, the immigrant and refugee, embodying God's presence and love for them? Will you say yes to God and take a stand with those who suffer injustice and demand God's justice for all? Will you say yes to whatever God is calling you? Our world is imperfect and quite a big mess, but that's right where we find God. I'd like to leave you with a poem by Madeline Lingle that captures this well. Christ did not wait till the world was ready, till people and nations were at peace. He came when the heavens were unsteady and prisoners cried out for release. He did not wait for the perfect time. He came when the need was deep and great. In the mystery of the Word made flesh, the Maker of the stars was born. We cannot wait till the world is sane to raise our songs with joyful voice, for to share our grief, to touch our pain. Christ came with love. Rejoice, rejoice. So if your life feels like a jumbled cardboard cutout of a nativity scene, remember Emmanuel, God with you, right there in the midst of that mess, and hold fast. Jesus comes with love.
I now invite you to stand and join with Christians around the world in reaffirming our faith with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray, saying, Christ, have mercy.
For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, Scott, our bishop, and for all bishops, ministers, and lay leaders, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For Donald, our president, Joe, our president-elect, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, for those who are serving in the military and all first responders, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For healthcare providers and support staff worldwide, and the patients in their care, for the aged and infirm, for refugees and victims, for the sick and the suffering, and for those we name now. Let us pray, Christ have mercy. For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray, Christ have mercy. In the communion of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to God.
To thee, Almighty God. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
May the God of hope fill you. May the God of joy overflow you. May the God of peace pour you into the world. May God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Amen. Go in peace to seek justice for all God's children.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.